Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming. It's been 2 weeks since we have seen each other. Thank you for coming for another session of Tuesday Times Roundtable, sponsored by the New York Times. This is a very special session. We have an amazing panel. We have the Spanish consulate. We'll do further introductions as we go along. But I have a couple of housekeeping items that I wanted to mention. For those that are honors college students and global medallion students, please come see one of us, Taylor, Sherry, or I at the end, so we can sign your forms. Also, as you may have seen, there's some release forms. This particular session, since it's very special, will be filmed from not only the presenters' angles, but your faces as well. So please make sure to sign those sheets. Taylor is collecting them. Is there anyone here that does not want to be filmed? Perfect. Okay. So please make sure to sign those forms. What else? There's food. I think that's it. I think that's it for today. Usually I go more into our programming and all of that, but today, since we have all these amazing guests, I don't want to take time from them. Thank you so much. And without further ado, I would like to introduce our executive director of the Office of Global Learning Initiatives, and my boss, Dr. Hilary Lendorf. Please join me in welcoming her.
Thank you. Thanks for coming, taking the time to come, and I hope you all got food. And my responsibility is to introduce Dr. Pablo Ortiz. Pablo Ortiz is the Vice President and Vice Provost for Regional and World Locations at FIU. He has more than 25 years of experience in education and is a leader in leveraging opportunities for FIU's internationalization opportunities, setting goals for each of our locations to address not only enrollment targets, but financial efficiencies, engagement, and research. In other words, Dr. Ortiz is able to identify and keep his eye on the big picture while honing in on the details at the same time. He has had many years of experience. He began his career as a teacher in Miami-Dade County Public Schools, and went on to serve as an elementary K through 8, middle and high school level principal for 12 years. Dr. Ortiz has been honored as the school district's only two-time Miami-Dade County Public Schools Principal of the Year in 2006 and 2012. He was also named recipient of the 2012-13 Principal Achievement Award for outstanding leadership as the top principal in the state of Florida. I've worked closely with Pablo for the past year since he's assumed his new role. For me, and I speak very sincerely, in addition to being a savvy businessman and possessing a tremendous work ethic, his greatest strength is his ability to listen. In meetings, whether they be one-on-one or large forums, rather than talk about himself or dwell on his accomplishments, Pablo sets a concrete agenda, asks important questions, allows everyone's voice to be heard, and I think most importantly, acknowledges and takes in others' perspectives with the utmost respect. To me, this is the key to Pablo's success and the reason why he's a true global learner. So please give us a warm welcome to Pablo Ortiz.
Thank you, Hilary. Good afternoon. Oh yeah, you have a mouthful of sandwich, I can tell. So I don't want to interrupt the lunch, but I do want to thank you all for joining us today. Today is certainly will be a very powerful conversation with a lot of great information that's going to be shared. First of all, I want to thank the Spanish consulate that has joined us today. And I know that the Consul General will be joining us very soon, as well as the FIU Department of Modern Languages that have worked very hard to put this together under the leadership, of course, of Hilary and the Global Learning team. And of course, Hillary, thank you again for the invitation. So welcome to the sixth roundtable in the Tuesday Times Roundtable. I want to make sure I had that number right, the sixth roundtable. And today, as I mentioned, is a very special conversation. So a little bit about myself. You heard some of the bio, but one of the responsibilities I have is to oversee FIU Global. FIU Global is really a new office that is now working across this university for two main purposes. Number one is to internationalize this campus, and number two is to provide global strategy. So as we are building our partnerships and opportunities around the world, we are building these partnerships in a strategic way that will not only help the students and the faculty, but also help the university grow its brand, grow its reputation, grow its friendships, grow its relationships, because, in case you didn't know this, we are, I think, the only large public university that has the word international in its name. We take that honor very seriously, and we want to leverage that title and that word in our name as Florida International University to help position this university not just on a local or national scale, but on a global scale as well. We currently have over 54 agreements around the globe. We do research in over 60 countries around the world. We have students, in fact, just this summer alone, we have students scheduled to take part, over 680 students scheduled to take part in educational experiences, either through student exchange or through study abroad. So it is something that for us, we're very passionate about. But specific to today, so today's topic is a multilingual future in a globalized world, the need for language learning education. We know and we recognize at FIU that language really serves as the cornerstone, right? It's the string that helps us weave this fabric, not only locally, but around the world, that helps connect us to people from all different backgrounds and all different parts of the globe. We recognize that language, not only is it important to learn because of the benefit that one has in terms of learning additional languages, but it also provides a sense of history, of culture, of understanding, of recognizing the values and the importance of acknowledging the many great assets and benefits that others from around the world bring to the table. And that is accomplished through the learning of language. Here in FIU, we have our English Language Institute that works very closely across the board in bringing students from abroad and helping them acquire the English language to a point that they can embed themselves into our university. And in most of those cases, believe it or not, those students are learning English as a third or fourth language. So we see the opportunities that we provide them by helping them increase their English capacity. As well, and I don't know if you know this, we have our Spanish program that we offer in Qingdao University in China, where we have almost 400 students participating in this program, close to 60 to 80 students that graduate every year with a degree in Spanish language, and again, learning a third language. And oh, by the way, they compete every year. They're usually in the top three performers in the entire country of China in terms of competitions for Spanish. And on a personal note for me, and you heard that some of my background was in the K-12 setting. As I was principal for a number of different schools, I had the distinct honor and pleasure of serving as principal at Coraway Elementary and then Coraway K-8. And Coraway is actually the first bilingual school in the country. And it was, and this program was started in 1963. I happened to be a student there, not in 1963. Just want to make that clear. But I was a student there, and I had the opportunity to come back years later as the principal of the school and saw the impact of having taught so many thousands of students in two languages, English and Spanish. And actually, we had a great partnership with the Consulate of Spain in terms of, and still do, in teaching the International Studies program as part of the curriculum. And then I had a chance to take that asset and that great opportunity onto a middle school, and I had a chance to open a brand new middle school with over 2,000 middle schoolers, and yes, I survived. Have more gray hair if you've ever had to be around middle schoolers. But what was unique about that program is every one of those 2,000 students studied in two languages, and half of their instruction on a daily basis was in Spanish. Again, another great partnership with the consulate as well, and we also added Mandarin Chinese, so students were learning in three languages. So this is an emphasis that not only FIU has, but this community has embraced for many years. So for us, that's why I feel that today is such an incredible opportunity. And I believe I have an introduction. So it's my pleasure at this point to introduce to you our esteemed guest, of today's roundtable. It's the Honorable Consul General of the Kingdom of Spain, Mr. Cándido Carés Estrada. Welcome. Cándido Carés is a career diplomat in the Spanish Foreign Office and since August 2015, the Consul General of Spain in Miami for Florida, Georgia, and South Carolina. In 1995, he took up his first assignment as head of foreign policy and security area at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Cooperation in Madrid. Since then, Mr. Carés has worked for the royal household of His Majesty the King of Spain as deputy director of the Department of Protocol from 1996 to 2001, and again as chief of protocol from 2011 to 2014. From 2001 to 2006, and 2009 and 2010, he worked at the permanent representation of Spain to the European Union in Brussels. From 06 to 09, Mr. Carés served as counselor at the Embassy of Spain in Tel Aviv. In 2009, he returned to Brussels to the permanent representation of Spain to the European Union. In 2010, he served as the chief of staff of the Undersecretary of the Spanish Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Cooperation in Madrid. And in his most recent post before coming to Miami, Mr. Carés served as vice commissioner of the Spanish Pavilion of the World Expo in Milan, Italy, from December 14 to July 15. He has a law degree from the Complutense University of Madrid and a course of English law from the University of Kent at Canterbury. We are very honored to have you here. Thank you very much for joining us. So with that, ladies and gentlemen, I pass it back over to those that have put this together. And again, thank you very much for joining us. And I know that you're going to get a tremendous amount of information from this discussion today.
Thank you. So much.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. I'd like to thank you for coming, and I'd like to thank Global Learning for inviting us and having us here today. So I'd like to thank Dr. Ortiz also for that wonderful introduction, and our Consul General, if you like, you can begin this discussion. Today's discussion is based on this article from the New York Times, Do You Speak My Language? You Should. And it's written by a European woman, a French woman, who says that, you know, she talks about the importance of learning a language, about really, really learning a language, about studying it in high school and in college and learning it, because this is going to have an effect for your career in the future, in business, in culture, and in language skills. Okay, so I'll leave it now to our council. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. First of all, please forgive I was late. I got a little bit lost. We had some sort of situation in the consular offices, that those these things happen. But anyway, always being late is not, it's unforgivable, so sorry about that. First of all, thank you very much for FIU. It's a great opportunity to be here. We have a very special relationship with FIU. It relates that we are in Florida, of course, but also because Florida International University, the focus of this university on international affairs is amazing. They have an excellent program with the SIPA, the Green, many foundations here, also Casa Cuba starting here as well. So it's a very Latin American oriented, but also Hispanic and Spanish. So thank you very much for all the staff, Doctor. Thank you very much for introductory words. I have been asked to say a few words. It will be short, although, you know, diplomats are, known for speaking quite a lot. On language, and what is language? The basis of language. Language reflects our reality. It reflects thinking. It reflects also culture. Some of the languages, for instance, have fewer verbal tenses. Others have more, like Spanish have subjunctive, others don't. If you speak Hebrew, for instance, so if you read Hebrew, you would know that many words are written without vowels. So that reflects this syncretic, really efficient way of thinking in what language is related to. Spanish, as you know, it's an easy language, at least to communicate more than 560 million people speak it all over the world. And that's a big asset. It's a big asset because it's the second or third language used in the internet. Very active community in Latin American countries. The younger generations are very focused on on using the internet. The cyber language, let me talk to you about a meeting I had some days ago with an expert, a Spanish expert in cybersecurity. We were talking about how, you know, through algorithms and big data, a song, you know, top modern songs can be already being composed. But he told me something very special, the problem with lyrics. Lyrics are not, for the time being, maybe, you know, someday it will be the case, but they told me it's almost impossible to use the lyrics or to through the internet, through the cyber program. And the difficulty is because words and language express emotions and also reflect, you know, the ways that a country thinks, for instance. In our case, as you know, Spain is a very a country with several languages. We have four official languages, what is called in Spain Castilian, so the Spanish, or the two Roman languages, which is Galician in Galicia. I don't know if you've acquainted with the geography of Spain, but it's in the northern part of Spain. Also Catalan as well, to the east coast, also a Roman language, very much related to French and Italian, but it's a unique language as well, with its own culture. And obviously, the Basque. The Basque is a very rare, very, it's a unique language that they've related it to the Ukraine region, the eastern, central eastern region, because it's a language, a very difficult language spoken there, that shares 200 words with the Basque language. So very unique in a way, the richness of the of Spanish culture, but also with the EU, where we belong. So there's French, English, there's also German, Polish, and so on. So a very rich community. Now the Spanish reality for us, and for the, we're very keen on learning new languages. And I think it related not only because we had our, you know, after the our civil war, we had a dictatorship and we were isolated. But also, there was keen people on traveling and on being also making business abroad. We have now more than 1,200,000 students that, even after 3 years of age, start a bilingual system, mainly in English. There are others, but mainly in English. All regions of Spain are devoted to this program. As you know, we have a sort of what we call autonomous region system. It's like a federal system. It's not exactly like the United States, but in many ways, for instance, all the education laws and legislation is passed and approved in general terms through the autonomous regions. That makes that the autonomous regions have a full capacity in organizing the way they teach. And they teach, some of the regions teach their own unique language, but also mainly in Spanish. And 80% of those 1,200,000 students, they do, 80% of the primary and secondary schools do this bilingual system. Now we have also the great help of, maybe some of you have already been participating in this program, what we call the Auxiliares de Conversación. These are students at the last years of the university studies. They decide to spend a year abroad. We are very, very happy to receive you. You are our best ambassadors. You bring with you your culture, but also you help us to understand the U.S. in this case, some others that come from Great Britain or France or other places, but also you absorb our culture. In, I don't know if you know this, but in 500 years ago, Magellan and Juan Sebastian Elcano, they discovered a route that went all the way through the seas, and they ratified the theory of the circular sphere theory of the world. And that, with that began 500 years ago the proto-globalization. So you are part now, and with the internet and social media and so on, you are now part of the globalization. through the auxiliares de conversación, we have more than 7,500 each year from different areas. They receive an stipend. They work between 14 and 16 hours a week with our students. For those of you that might be interested, we have you know, the possibility for you to participate. There are, you can register before the 15th of April. But they have a great time. Those who have done this program have a great time. And then the most important thing, they come back to the US and they start building up the bilingual, bicultural, bi-alphabet system. The cooperation with the US, in our terms, it's more than 1,000, almost 100, 1,300 teachers, Spanish teachers, in mainly in Canada and the US. In ratio, you have almost 1,000 of women. And I have to tell you, I think it's a very, very, for us, it's a, we are lucky to you know, have these Spaniards here, and also about 200, it relates to, or it works with 233 school districts, 35 states, mainly in Texas, 359 teachers. In Florida, we have 95 teachers. And overall, and this is, for me, I discovered this is a massive, really interesting figure, more than 73,000 U.S. students in primary and secondary school, they embark in the knowledge and the learning of the two languages. This is a massive, for us, a massive way of the soft diplomacy. You know, diplomacy is not just relates to the, you know, the red telephone or the royal visit or a presidential visit to our country, but it relates to the work the social network does, and that's specifically you. It's us as diplomats, as we have a wonderful, in the US, let me tell you, I have to praise, officially praise, the work of the counselor. We have a counselor for education affairs in Washington, but we do have the great luck to have here a magnificent team of work of workforce in Miami, which is the Agregaduría Cultural, so the attaché, the education attaché, Spanish here in our consular offices. So we're very lucky having them and promoting all these culture. Finally, benefits. What is benefit about learning two languages, the bi-alphabet? Bilingual and bicultural. I have to, let me also praise the work that the Miami-Dade County educational system does, and also a specific praise to those teachers participating in the seven schools that are part of the double language system. ISPA, ISH, my children go to ISH, and I have to tell you, it's public learning, it's a you know, the reach of many people, even with very low income, and it's their future. It really is going to make a difference. And why is that? The valuable, it's very valuable in revenue. It's valuable in trade because you're not going to just relate to Spain, but also to the rest of Latin America, of tourism. Florida is a state based on tourism. I've met several people that they were chosen with the same capacities or the same level of knowledge of other colleagues. They were selected because they were bilingual. Another anecdote, I was yesterday in West Palm Beach Airport, and I was speaking to an officer of Customs and Border Protection. I wasn't allowed to say you how much more this person earns per year, but let me tell you, it's more than four figure amount yearly, which they get before Christmas, so it's a nice bonus, just for using both languages, English and Spanish. And they do it on a regular basis. So, and that's a way for me, also being a Spanish official, to understand how efficient and also how pragmatic the US society is. You have that capacity, you have that added value, and then you get rewarded for that. And that allows people to see that there's an added value in learning, and it's reflected in the wages. And also, I also use this anecdote, you know, on learning different languages, on the continuous learning process that we all fulfill, which is, you know, combating Alzheimer. It's been proved that, you know, the more knowledge you have in languages, in music as well, and in other areas, it helps to stabilize and I wouldn't say get better, unfortunately, not yet, but definitely to improve your cognitive capacities. Now, the Spanish offer, let me finish with this note, because I'm the Consul General for Spain. For you to discover Spain, discover our culture, we have a magnificent university summer courses. Spain is a very, very diverse country and also very open to, you know, different people. To we had a same sex marriage very early as well, so it's very, very open. We have obviously, you know, some challenges to face, of course, but in general terms, it's what Lope de Vega, which is a very famous 16th, 17th century poet in Spain, about, it's a sonnet about love, and he says that the person who has tasted love, they know it. So if you go to Spain, you'll understand what I'm talking about. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Consul. Okay, the next speaker is Dr. Marisa Filgueras Gomez. She is an assistant professor here at FIU. She obtained her PhD in Spanish Applied Linguistics at Georgetown University. Her main research interests include second language acquisition, bilingualism, heritage language development, and education and foreign language teacher education. Marisa.
Thank you so much for that presentation. And so I'm gonna talk a little bit brief, but I think hopefully later we have some time for questions, or do you hear me well? Is it good? Okay, so the topic of this talk in general is the multilingual world, the need for language learning education. And the first question I wanna ask is, I mean, we are in Miami. There's a lot of us that do speak some languages other than English, so why do we need foreign language education here in Miami? Really, specifically with Spanish. So how many of you do speak some Spanish? Just tell me about it. Some of you also like understand some of it. Some of you feel that you have like good skills in reading, in writing, and whatnot, right? So why am I gonna go and spend my time learning something that I already know? So actually, let me tell you, there is a need. And let me tell you an anecdote that happened very recently to a colleague of mine. So in January, a colleague of mine received an email from somebody whose company has a branch here in Miami. It's a tourist company. And this company has a PR person, a PR representative. And this the manager of the company was contacting us because the representative is considers himself a Spanish native speaker, and is very good in speaking Spanish and projecting a public image of the company. But when it comes to writing and giving arguments in Spanish, he's got a lack there. He doesn't have enough skills there. So this person particularly contacted us in the Mother Languages Department at FIU, say, what do you have? Because I have a good speaker, but his skills in writing are not up to the level. So what do we have, right? Now, let me just tell you specifically, who is this person? Who is this Spanish native speaker who can speak but can't really write that well? He's a heritage bilingual, a heritage speaker. He's a person who grew up speaking or listening to Spanish, but and have some skills, good skills in some parts, but not so good in other parts. And he already mentioned them, and she's gonna really talk to them. So let me tell you what we do here at FAU. So we have the Spanish Heritage Language Program, okay? This program builds on our students' proficiency and skills, and expand all their skills in different aspects. We also promote linguistic security, which is a really important aspect. We have students here at FIU that say, oh, you know, I understand Spanish, but I wouldn't speak it in front of other people because I've been ashamed some other people say that I don't speak good Spanish. We foster linguistic security. We want our students to feel secure about their skills and to provide them with opportunities to improve those skills. We also want them to be able to communicate with increased accuracy and fluency in topics and contexts that are beyond just talking to your abuelita, right? I mean, it's nice. We want to do that. We want to keep that. And please do not forget that. But we also want to be the person who works in that company and has good, strong skills giving an argument in Spanish, writing and reading, right? So we want to develop also and enhance their writing and reading in Spanish and become bilateral individuals, which is what he already mentioned, right? So what else do we do in our department? Well, it's not only Spanish. We have more languages, and I have some representation over here. So we have, we teach Arabic, we teach French, Chinese, German, Haitian Creole. There's a big community here in Miami of Haitian Creole. We also teach Japanese, Korean, Portuguese, and Russian. We offer some professional programs, specifically in translation, a certificate for Spanish and English on interpretation and translation, a minor, if you don't do the entire certificate, on translation with English and Spanish and English and French, and a professional certificate for those students who are going to be in the fields of business, hospitality, or health. We also have some internships. These internships are, some of them, in the Teacher of Foreign Languages. So we have a very nice relationship with the Miami-Dade Public Library school system. And we have interns that go over there and they teach Spanish. So they have that opportunity. We also have a book club where my colleague, Dr. Baral, is creating, Dr. Baral with the intern, is creating reading guides for parents to help their kids to improve and learn how to read Spanish since they are little. We also have a very nice internship where our goal is to promote successful Black language learners. And another type of internship where we are creating books, children books for Haitian Creole learners too. Then we also have two more internships in the translation and interpretation, one specifically for the judicial interpretation and another one for the professional interpretation as well. Finally, for outreach in our community and specifically thinking about teacher education, we have a partnership here with CIVER, which let me remember exactly, is the Center for International Business Education and Research, which is part of the business school. And we give workshops for Spanish teachers. We also have what is called the My Bridge workshops for teachers of Spanish, but for minority serving institutions. And the My Bridge workshops are specifically the minority institutions building resources to ignite development and growth in education. And our goal is to provide more information to these future teachers. Because the whole idea is to have you being those ninjas and that in the future you will see, yes, mm-hmm. that paid off. So that's all I have to say.
Thank you so much. I was a heritage speaker, so I understand that perfectly. Next is Dr. Alina Diaz Blanco. Dr. Alina Diaz Blanco is the proud principal of International Studies Preparatory Academy. It's called ISPA. I'm a proud parent of that school. I'd also like to say, I have to cut the biography a little short because of time, but I'd like to say something that I feel is very important. She's an FIU alumni, and she's very excited about that. So please, Dr. Blanco.
Thank you for having me. International Studies Preparatory Academy, ISPA, is an all-language magnet high school in Miami-Dade County Public Schools. The students pursue language studies in addition to an academic curriculum with an international focus that addresses the rigorous standards not only of the United States, but also of the European Union. In addition to the subjects taught in English, the students receive up to 3 hours of daily instruction in their program of study, which is either Spanish, French, or Italian. The goal and objective of our diverse education activities allows students to emerge in a culture of the language program that they are enrolled in. They're exposed to diverse cultures. Of the 370 students that are in the school, there are 38 different countries represented. So with a very small number of students, you can see the percentage of how many countries are represented in that one building. Our students get experience to other cultures from their peers, their teachers, as well as the instruction in their humanities courses. When you unlock the language of a culture, you unlock the key to the culture and its people. The different humanities classes follow an international curriculum with the assistance of the consulates of both Italy, France, and Spain. They provide us with textbooks, they provide us with current curriculums, and as in the case with the Spanish consulate, we are one of the schools that has visiting teachers from Spain that come to us and teach our students. The humanities classes also provide the students with a virtual tour of the country. They're learning about poets, about artists, about authors. Many times, those individuals are also invited to the school. So the students are getting in their language classes, they're getting the writing, the reading, the speaking, because in those classrooms, it's only that language of study. But then in the humanities classes, they're getting that cultural aspect and the diversity aspect. We also have a lot of field trips to expand their linguistic capacity and cultural appreciation. This also allows the students to serve as intermediaries with France, and as the consulate said, we're building soft diplomacy. We're having these students within our own school. In fact, our superintendent, Dr. Carvalho, refers to us many times as a mini United Nations for that purpose, that the in a very small space, you have different cultures represented, and the students are constantly having those conversations and appreciating each other's diversity and culture. Our goal is to create global citizens. Many of our students are not only bilingual, but trilingual, and we have students that sometimes graduate speaking all four languages, English, Spanish, French, and Italian. This obviously provides them with many opportunities in the workplace when they graduate. But also, as part of the school, we offer them other opportunities like Model UN. We just had 12 students come back from New York yesterday. They were at the United Nations in a Model UN conference. So again, it's preparing these students, and living in Miami gives them that opportunity. And it goes back to that conversation about the Miami Spanish, which I am guilty of speaking. And having the knowing the difference with that proficiency when you're able to read, write, articulate effectively with companies in those countries. Our school success is evidenced by our data. In the past 2 years, we have 100% graduation rate. With that being said, let it be known that of those 100% that are graduating, at least 20% of them were ESOL students when they came into the school, meaning they only spoke either Spanish or French or Italian. But with the immersion program and having both their home language or their native language and English, they were able to meet the requirements and graduate proficient in both languages. As at ISPA, again, we pride ourselves in linguistic and cultural diversity and acceptance. And thank you for having us here. And if you ever by South Miami, come by and visit our school. We will be more than happy to show you all the wonderful things that are going on there.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay, well, the consul spoke a little bit about a program that we have, the Cultural Ambassadors Program. I'm going to speak a little bit about that afterwards. But now Esther Izquierdo is going to speak because she's going to do the flip side. She's going to explain to you the flip side of this program. Esther Izquierdo is here thanks to a grant from the Ministry of Education of Spain and thanks to the Department of Modern Languages and FIU. And she comes here as a cultural ambassador for Spain, and she's going to explain a little bit of her experience and what that's meant to her. Okay, so Esther, thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. So I am so pleased to be here today because I am not an expert yet, hopefully someday. But I am going to talk about my experience. And as I will tell you later, learning a new language opened a whole new world of opportunities for me. So I work at the Spanish Resource Center, which is located in the Green Library in room 593B. And we have plenty of Spanish books and films there, or if you're learning Spanish skills, feel free to come by at any time. As a linguistics student, I learned about grammar, about syntax, about phonetics, and basically anything related to language. But there is a concept that actually left a mark on me, and that is linguistic relativity. The weak version of this idea states that language somehow influences the way we think and the way we perceive the world. So this means that our language is also a reflection of our culture. So there's an example for you to understand a little bit better this idea. These examples are for languages with two forms of the second person pronouns, such as Spanish or French. And as for these languages, your choice marks your relationship with the interlocutor. So we are somehow forced to categorize every person we talk to in terms of social hierarchy, which is something that English speakers don't really do. And we have to do it while we're speaking to that person, so it gets kind of difficult sometimes. These examples show that not only are we learning a new language, but also we are discovering its inner and culture. So we are getting to experience the world through a native speaker's eyes, which is a beautiful idea. In a multilingual country like Spain, different languages and the linked cultures coexist in the same space. This only appears to happen in some regions of Spain, which are marked in different colors. But children living in these dual language areas of Spain have to learn both languages at school, and they even have to enroll in courses taught in both languages at university. So these people obviously have more opportunities since they can apply for jobs requiring both the region and the national language. In my case, I live in the central area of Spain, which unfortunately is monolingual, but we start taking English lessons at the age of 3 at school, and then I decided to learn French at high school and German at university. Thanks to learning English, I was able to spend a year abroad in Canterbury, England, 2 years ago. I studied at the University of Kent, which I serve with the consulate, and I met wonderful people from all around the world. But besides making new friends, I also got familiar with English people's politeness, with the British accent, and with team meetings, which is a very cultural thing of England. This experience also taught me how to be on my own, how to be far away from my family and my friends, and I basically started taking care of myself by myself. So I also stopped feeling shy about speaking English to other people, like today, and I focused on living in English, and I really mean it, I started dreaming in English. 2 years later, here I am on the other side of the world, and I am enjoying every day of being a language and culture assistant here at FIU. This experience might be a little bit different since it is more related to work, so it means growing up in the business field and building a successful career. But up to now, I have never stopped learning, and that is because amazing people are always willing to teach me every single day. This is the reason why I am now open to help people improve their Spanish language skills and also to learn a little bit more about the Spanish culture and Spanish lifestyle. However, following the path of learning different languages and living in different culture, countries and interacting with other cultures has not been easy at all. Of course, I feel a little bit homesick sometimes, and I miss people, I miss places, I miss the food. but nevertheless, I think these experiences are totally worth it because everything that I miss is waiting for me to come home anytime. So I believe that people can find personal growth and achievement in diversity. So I encourage everyone to discover different and new ways of seeing the world and experiencing the world, and also to work on respecting them, which is probably the hardest part of all. Thanks to learning a new language, I'm able to be here today speaking to you, and I couldn't be more grateful for it. So thank you so much for listening.
Thank you so much, Esther. You see how happy she is. So now I'm going to explain very briefly this program that we have in Spain, and hopefully some of you will take interest and will like to do it. Okay, do you hear the music? Do you know what song that is? Yeah? The Macarena. Yeah, we do this in Spain. So this is another great thing. To go do. All right, this is a brief overview of the program. It's a video, and from there, I'll explain in some more detail.
Fancy living in Spain? Join the Language and Culture Assistance Program of the Education Office of the Spanish Embassy. It offers a fantastic opportunity to spend a school year in Spain as an assistant teacher, sharing your language and knowledge with Spanish students K through 12 and adults.
Con ella aprender inglés es estupendo. Chloe es la mejor.
I got medical insurance and a monthly allowance to help pay for accommodation and expenses. And I really think that this experience will help with my career in the future.
Spain also offers you amazing travel and cultural possibilities.
I couldn't have imagined this was going to be such a life-changing experience.
What about the food?
And the lively streets.
And the wonderful people.
Yo he mejorado mucho mi español.
Don't miss this opportunity. Learn more about the Language and Culture Assistance Program of the Education Office of the Embassy of Spain.
And grow as you share.
So, a little bit about the program. The American Language and Cultural Assistance Program is an educational outreach initiative of the Ministry of Education of Spain that offers American and Canadian students who are native speakers of English the opportunity to be teachers' assistants in Spain. The reason for this, and some of our speakers mentioned it before, it's that the Spanish government wants to have a native speaker in each classroom, in each school in Spain, because that's a really great way of learning the language. Okay, the language assistants can also learn about the language and culture of Spain and use the experience upon their return to the United States, whether it be in the field of teaching, of business, or any other. It promotes a cultural link to this between the citizens of these countries, which is why the embassy is involved. Where will you be sharing this? Well, in elementary schools, in secondary schools. In Europe, we don't usually have middle schools that Dr. Diaz was referring to. They're very dangerous, right? Middlebury schools for the teachers and the principals, I think. We put them all together. And what we call language schools, which are schools that are only dedicated to the teaching of languages. Here it would be with adult students and not children, obviously all in Spain. So why go to Spain? Well, maybe somebody would like to go do the running of the bulls. I don't know if anyone's interested in that. We have great food festivals. This one is about tomatoes. We have other festivals. This is a very famous festival in Valencia where there are puppets based that are made based on current events and then they're burnt. We have history, tons and tons of history. This is an aqueduct. We have churches, mosques, palaces, cathedrals. Does anyone know what this is? Yes, exactly, in Bilbao, exactly, the Guggenheim Museum in Bilbao. We have beaches. This is hard to sell in Miami, but we have really great beaches. I can offer you snow also. Culture, like opera, and then the food, right, which we've been talking about, which is absolutely wonderful. You're familiar with paella, with chocolate con churros, right, and these kind of things. These are the different regions of Spain, so if anyone is interested in applying, they have to research, they have to decide if they would rather go to a small town in the mountains or a big city on the coast, so you have to explore, do some research on the internet for that, Okay. Requirements, you have to have a valid U.S. passport. You have to be a U.S. citizen. You have to be a native speaker of English. You have to have a basic, very basic level of Spanish, okay? Be a college junior or senior or a college graduate or have an associate degree or be a community college student in their last year. Be in good physical and psychological health. Have a clean background check. And your date of birth must be after October 1st, 1960, which I think everyone here is set with that one, right? Okay, what will you be doing? You'll be working, you'll be a teacher's assistant. Working under the supervision of a classroom teacher, you'll always be in the class with a classroom teacher. You'll never be alone with the children. Your tasks will include usually conducting conversation lessons, presenting cultural presentations, and maybe attending departmental meetings. Okay? Extracurricular activities, workshops, cultural activities, field trips, school plays, musical performances, or sports events. The program conditions, as I said before, you pick three destinations, so you have to do your research. You will receive a monthly stipend of about 700 to 1,000 euros, depending on the region of Spain where you want to go. Now, this may not seem like a lot, but it covers a modest living, okay? The cost of living is lower in Spain than it is in the United States, and then also many times we find that language assistants or cultural ambassadors are able to get some extra supplements with doing some private tutoring in English or things like that, okay? The length of the program, it's 8 months, October 1st to May 31st. Your schedule, so here's the really good part about this. You'll only be working for about 12 to 16 hours a week, and they'll usually fix your schedule so that you have a three-day weekend. So that's gonna allow you to do a lot of traveling around Spain and around Europe. Has anyone ever heard of something called Ryanair? Yeah, have you heard of it? Yeah, it's an airline company. I have nothing to do with the company, but you can get really cheap flights. Like I'm talking like maybe $20 for, you know, a Madrid Paris kind of thing or something like that. So you'll be able to do a lot of traveling. Medical insurance, an orientation course at the beginning of the school year, an official certificate upon completion, paid school vacations. Okay, for example, Christmas and Easter, so that'll give you, again, a lot of time off and a lot of time to travel, okay? And you have an option to renew for a second year with a positive evaluation from the school, okay? The application process, there are no fees, it's free. See how happy Rachel and Phoebe are? Yeah? Okay. And you apply online through a software program that is called Profix, and it's on a first-come, first-served basis, the destinations, the assignments, okay? The deadline is April 15th, in case you're interested in applying this year. If you're not interested in applying this year, maybe it's something to think about in the future, maybe when you graduate college, after you're not sure what you want to do. And this is a really wonderful experience, especially for personal growth, which is what Esther was talking to you about before. Okay, this is our website, just so that you know what it looks like. Well, you have all the information. And here, you're gonna see just a short video of someone who did this, and he put this video together. Everyone's very excited about the food there. Yeah, there must be a reason for that. He really liked these light shows. He mentions them a lot. Thank you. you guys can sing about Florida, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so what am I going to say? There's nothing else quite like Spain. It's a beautiful country filled with beautiful people and wonderful food.
Yeah.
Okay, so if you would like more information, you can email us at this address, or you can also look up Cultural Ambassadors in Spain. It's a wonderful program. We send over more than 4,000 Americans every year, and as you're learning about Spain and its culture and its language, you also learn a lot about yourself, about your language, and your culture, and then you bring this back with you when you come back home. So I hope that many of you will think about it and want to participate in the program. So we're done for today. If you have any questions, we'd love to answer them, any of us, any of the speakers.
Thank you so much, everyone, for coming. Again, if you have any questions, I want to be mindful of everyone's time. It's 1:30. I know some of you have classes. But please approach and please, if you want to say it on the now, please let us know. Taylor and I will approach the mics. Yes. Just dedicate a few minutes.
Thank you. Okay, I see that for the requirements it said junior, senior, or graduate.
Right.
And
right.
So to your knowledge, do you see if there's less opportunity or less chances for a graduate, or it's equal,
no,
treated
it's even,
equal?
It's even. It's first come, first serve basis.
First come, first serve.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Exactly, yeah.
I did not expect that today, so you made my day today. Thank you with that. That is an amazing opportunity.
It really is. It really is. I really hope you guys think about it because it is an amazing opportunity. It's something you'll take with you through your whole life. Yeah, definitely.
Hi. I would like to thank the... Do you hear me?
A little.
Yeah. A little. Okay, I would like to thank the panelists and for inspiring the students in traveling abroad, in learning a foreign language. I also would like to point out that foreign language education needs a lot of support from our public schools, for our schools in general, and our universities, included FIU, Florida International University, because unfortunately today, foreign language is a little bit under siege and is struggling sometimes to provide students with a variety of foreign language opportunities and exposure. And this may not be the audience, but it would be important for the university to think of ways in which we can insensitize our students to pursue foreign language education and to get a different perspective on the world. You know, several of our speakers have mentioned that our language carries culture and helps you see things in a different way and interpret the words in various modes. So, you know, and I want to thank the Consulate General of Spain altogether for over the years, you know, supporting our efforts at the university here. And we still need your support and to also talk to our various officials at FIU to reinforce the idea that foreign language is a critical skill for employability for the students and for all kinds of other reasons, foreign language is important. We are in a world where, you know, building bridges is very important today more than ever, and you know, be empathetic and so forth. So that's what I wanted to say, and I hope that all here you will continue, you or will start your foreign language education, and you were inspired by today.
Thank you so much, everyone, for coming once again. And again, we have to be mindful of everyone's time. So please, if you have any further questions, please feel free to approach us, to approach them, not me. Well, you can ask me questions anytime. But again, thank you so much. And I will ask for the panelists if we, before you leave, we can take a group picture.
Oh, of course.
Before you leave. But thank you, please.
Thank you, everyone. Yes.
Thank you.